Amen. Good morning. Welcome to Bethel Christian Reformed Church. My name is Justin Bailey. I teach theology at Dordt College here in town. It's my privilege to get to open the Word with you for the next three Sundays in our series on the Psalms. Our family has just returned from Southern California for the last 2 weeks, and I always think of that place as the land with no seasons. And it's nice to be back in a place, even though it's the same season as it was there. It was 116 there, and then we came back, and our air conditioning was broken here, and so very similar. But it's nice to be in a place that has seasons. I forgot about that. We lived in California for a few years, and when it was winter from January until April, and then when it rained so much, these were things I was not used to. But the seasons invite us to consider the way that as life changes, as life ebbs and flows, and we go through different stages, that God's faithfulness and God's fidelity to us is the same in every season of our life. Not just when things are sunny outside, but when the basement floods, when things aren't going the way that we want them to go, that God's fidelity is the one thing that we count on every single day, every single moment of our life. And that's why we come together on Sunday to celebrate that. So will you join me as we pray together this morning? Almighty God, you know that we come to this place with our minds on many things. We have many anxieties, cares, and concerns. And so as we hear your call to worship this morning, as we sing these songs and hear your word, pray these prayers, greet one another, will you help us to fix our attention on one thing, the one thing that is needful, your beauty, your glory, your presence with us today. Set us free from our self-absorption. Set us free from our obsession with things going our way. And help us to trust in you with all our hearts and lean not to our own understanding, in all our ways to acknowledge you as you make our paths straight. And may this service of worship be for us the help that we need to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. We desire to see Jesus today and to walk out of here as his emissaries of peace. We pray this in his name. Amen. Will you stand with me and hear this call to worship from Psalm 111. Praise the Lord. I will extol the Lord with all my heart in the council of the upright and in the assembly. Great are the works of the Lord. They are pondered by all who delight in them. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. He provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise. And so that call in mind, because to God belong eternal praise, regardless of how we feel, regardless of what's true of us, there are certain things that are true about God in every season. And so we come together in worship to sing together as God's people about these things that are true regardless of how we feel. So will you join me in this opening hymn amid the thronging worshipers?
Thank you.
receive now this greeting. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. God welcomes us here in mercy and grace, and we in turn welcome one another. Let's take a moment now to greet those around us, especially those who are here for the first time.
We invite you to remain standing and sing with us one more song of praise when trials come.
When trials come, no longer fear, for in the pain faithfulness is told, and there is faithfulness is told. Within the night I know your peace, the breath of God brings strength to me, and who is morning mercy flows. As treasures
team forward that's going down to Florida next week Sunday. There are more than this. I think we're missing a couple this morning.
Our group is preparing to go on a mission trip through Youth Works to Daytona Beach, Florida, July 22 through 27. We will be working with a number of community organizations down there, including food pantries, clothing distribution centers, soup kitchens, children's programs, and elderly care facilities. We would like to thank the mission committee for their financial support and the congregation for supporting our fundraisers and making this into a possibility. The theme of our devotions during the week is onward. We will be focusing on Philippians 1 verse 6 and the process of moving forward towards the completion of the good work Christ is doing in us.
And now we just invite you to participate in a commissioning with us this morning. When asked which commandment in the law is greatest, Jesus replied,
all your mind, is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself.
As you embark on this mission trip to Daytona Beach, Florida, these twin statements converge as one. As you travel to be fully physically, spiritually, and mentally present with others in a different place and circumstance as yourself, you express a love of God with your whole self. As you learn and grow from the experience, your neighbor's lives become entwined with yours so that you will be changed when you return.
We pray for servant hearts as we commit to being the hands and feet of Jesus this week.
We ask that you guys pray for us next week Sunday as we head down there, but we'd like to just have a quick prayer of blessing as well. So I invite you to extend a hand forward towards the group as we just offer a prayer of blessing. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, as we anticipate a trip next week Sunday down to Florida, we just pray a blessing over it. We pray for safety in travel. We pray for unity in our group. And we just pray that we can be your hands and feet as we come into contact with people of different backgrounds, different life experiences. We pray that we can be there to serve them, but we pray that we can also be there to learn from them and to grow. That we can see your handy marksmanship on their lives. That we can see your spirit, your will in them. And so, God, we just pray that we can have servant hearts, that we can be a blessing, and that we can be blessed. And just help us to grow together as a group and to grow closer to you as well. We pray that you be with the other two churches that will be at the site with us. And we just pray for unity as a group and that we can glorify you in our worship and in our work. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen.
Our prayer of confession this morning is from Psalm 23. We often find comfort in Psalm 23 and recite the words in seasons of sorrow and uncertainty, clinging with hope and assurance to his promises. But Psalm 23 can also be used as a guide in confession, reflecting in each promise our failure to grasp his goodness and our lack of thankfulness. Please join me in a prayer. Our shepherd and Lord, we ask your forgiveness when we take your care for granted, and when in the midst of your many blessings, we long for more. Lord, forgive us when in the presence of uncertainty or in the midst of hurt, we fail to trust your love. Forgive our reluctance to fully feast on what you have seen fit to provide, and our failure to daily dwell in your presence. Call us back into your care and restore our trust, that our actions may proclaim your goodness. Amen.
Together, let's sing of the Lord's promise of assurance and our grateful response. Please join us as you are able on verse 2.
Shepherd of my soul, come dwell within me. Take all I am and mold your likeness in me. Before the cross of Christ, this is my sacrifice. A life laid down and ready to follow. Troubled find their peace in true surrender. The prisoners they're released from chains of anger. In springs of living grace, I find a resting place to rise refreshed eternally to follow. Is narrow
Will you pray with me as we prepare to hear God's word? So, Lord, we have reflected this morning on our failures and your faithfulness, our tendency to doubt and to wander, and your commitment to pursue us with your love. And now as we hear that again, the promises of your word, may it be more than words on a page or words in the mouth of an ordinary man, but may we hear your voice. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of the Lord. So this text is a familiar one. Not just in the church, but in popular culture as well. It's amazing that in our contemporary society, Psalm 23 continues to have this purchase on our imagination. In popular music and film, it's a passage that even irreligious people recognize. People who might otherwise not think much about God. Why is that the case? Sheep herding is not even a major part of our culture. And yet when we hear these words, the Lord is my shepherd, we intuitively seem to know what the psalmist is talking about. In fact, we feel a sense of comfort just from hearing those words. Why? Why is this psalm so widely used at funerals, at those times when we feel the most the pain of parting? When we feel most that we are alone. Perhaps it is because this psalm is unrivaled in assuring us of God's presence when we are weak and in the wilderness. We read these words daring to hope that this kind of peace is actually possible, even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Now, the placement of Psalm 23 raises the stakes even more because Psalm 23 is preceded directly by Psalm 22. And Psalm 22 opens with these words, words so poignant that Jesus himself took them up on the cross. My God, why did you leave me so alone? That's Psalm 22, verse 1. And then when we get to Psalm 23, verse 1, we hear, the Lord is my shepherd. Is the comfort of Psalm 23 really possible after the abandonment of Psalm 22? Well, Psalm 23 tells us that God's peace and the promise of God's presence is possible. In fact, it shows us that it is possible to walk through the darkest and loneliest times of life if we know who God is. That God's presence is enough to bring us through many hardships and all the way to the end. Now, this psalm breaks into three primary movements. Verses 1 through 3 show us a portrait of a God who goes before us, ahead of us, leading us as a shepherd leads the flock. And then verses 4 and 5 show us a God who walks beside us. And then verse 6 tells us that God's goodness and mercy come behind us. So God is before us, beside us, and behind us. It's because of that picture of comprehensive care that we know that he can be trusted, body and soul, in life and in death. So this is the structure for the sermon this morning. The God who goes before us, the God who walks beside us, the God who comes behind us. Let's take the first, the God who goes before us. Now, again, the focus in these first three verses is of God as a shepherd who goes before the flock, leading the sheep in the wilderness. Now, David is in a place where fear is natural. We know this because he describes himself as a sheep. You know that sheep, in this part of the world at least, don't go wild when they're separated from the flock. They die. Dogs may go wild, horses may go wild, but sheep separated from the flock get shredded by predators because their only defense mechanism is to climb. And so to describe himself as a sheep is to make this profound admission of helplessness. I feel like a sheep separated from the flock, and if I don't have a shepherd, I will not go wild. I'll die. This is a picture of dangers around him and fears within him. And so in the face of those kinds of fears, rather than being paralyzed by them, David reaches out to God, but he doesn't ask God for anything. Notice that there are no requests in this psalm. Instead, what we find here is this ruthless expression of trust. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. What does it mean to say that? I shall not be in want. Well, let me tell you what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that you deaden your desires. It doesn't mean I don't ever want anything. What it means is to deepen your desires and to say that I know that God knows what I need and he will lead me into what I need in time. Because there may be times when the sheep lack green pastures. There may be times when the sheep are thirsty and long for quiet waters. But it's not their job to find those things. The shepherd who goes before them, that's his job, to lead them there, to lead them to the place where they can rest. My brother-in-law is a pilot, and whenever I fly with him, he reminds me that flying is much safer than driving. Statistically, very few people die in plane crashes. But if you were to ask most people, when do you feel safer when you go up in a plane or when you sit behind the wheel of a car, most people would say, I feel much safer driving. And that's how I feel. In fact, every time we take off, I say this little prayer. God, I give myself to you. And why is that the case? Why do we feel safer driving than flying? Well, because you have the wheel. And the wheel gives you the illusion of control. When in reality, we know that all sorts of other things could intervene and take away that illusion. But we love to have the illusion of control. But on a plane, the illusion is gone. You must entrust yourself to another, someone whose knowledge of flight far exceeds your own. You must let the pilot do his job. You don't need to know how to fly through clouds. That's his job. Trust the pilot. It's the same way with sheep and a shepherd. And it's the same way with us and God. You don't have to know the future. You don't have to be able to predict how everything will go. That's not your job. To say that the Lord is your shepherd, to believe that he is leading you towards green pastures, towards quiet waters, is to trust the Lord's leadership. It's to lay down the illusion of control, your need to be in control, and to trust him. To believe that you are being led by one who will restore your soul, who will lead you in paths of righteousness. Why? For his name's sake. Because of who he is. Because of what he has promised. In fact, there's a verse just two psalms later that's connected to this, Psalm 25, verse 10, that goes like this. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. That verse is saying that as we follow and obey the Lord, no matter what adversity we walk through, there's no path you could walk that won't be already paved by God's loyal love and faithfulness. He has already gone before you. He has blazed the trail. He knows where he is leading you. Will you trust him? The psalmist says, I may not know where the green pastures are. I may not know where the quiet waters are, but that's okay. That's not my job. Because I am confident that my shepherd knows, and he is leading me there. God goes before us. And this gives us hope to keep walking. It gets better than that, though, in verses 4 and 5. Because verses 4 and 5 show us now a portrait of a God who walks beside us. He doesn't just go before us, but he's beside us. Notice that here the psalmist shifts from talking about God in the third person to talking to God in the second person. Instead of saying, he makes me lie down, now he says, you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, as if the God who was once before is now right here. Not a he, but a you. I think there's several reasons for this shift. First, there's a shift because we're shifting from the shepherd who goes before and gives provision to now the one who walks beside and gives protection. Second, the natural response to acknowledging the truth about God is to speak to God. So we don't just talk about God's leadership, we talk to God in prayer and praise, because God is not a force, but a person, not far away, but near. And third, I think there's a shift from he to you, because it's often in the valley, when we are most afraid, most in need of God, that God becomes the most real to us. Think of what Job says near the end of that book. I had heard of you, but now I see you. Because it's in the deep times that we experience God no longer as an idea, but as a reality. You. 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 There's a book I use with my students at Dordt that was written 350 years ago, and yet it remains surprisingly relevant. Maybe some of you have read it. It's called The Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan. It's an allegory of a Christian's journey from the city of destruction to the city of God. And along the way, all of the characters and struggles that he has are symbolic of the sorts of struggles that we face as we try to walk with God. And so there's this one point during which Christian actually walks through a valley called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. It's a dark valley full of pits and quicksand, and this is Bunyan's description. I'm going to read a good portion here. The pathway was extremely narrow. Good Christian, therefore, was seriously challenged, for when he sought in the dark to avoid the ditch on the one hand, he was close to tipping into the mire on the other. And when he sought to escape the mire without great care, he would be ready to fall into the ditch. He went on like this, and I heard him sigh bitterly, for besides the dangers mentioned above, the pathway was so dark here that often when he lifted up his foot to go forward, he did not know where or upon what he would set it down next. He heard threatening voices and rushing about, so that sometimes he thought he would be torn in pieces or trodden down like mud in the roads. After Christian had traveled in this sad condition for a considerable time, he thought he heard the voice of a man, as if it were going before him, saying, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." Now, in the story, hearing this voice in the valley gives Christian hope and courage for three reasons. First, hearing the voice of another lets him know that he's not the only one in the valley. There's someone else walking through it too. Second, if God was with that person, that he can hear his voice, that maybe God will also be with him. And third, maybe if he keeps walking a little bit faster, he can catch up to this person and have companionship. I think it's the same sort of thing that's supposed to happen as we read Psalm 23. We hear David speak in the midst of his fears, and it gives us hope. We're not the only ones to have walked through the valley of shadow. Someone has gone before us.
And if God was with David, perhaps he is with us just as much, even if we cannot perceive it. So we read this psalm and we find companionship with the psalmist, and his comfort becomes our comfort. Even though I walk through the valley, I will not be afraid. Do we have even though faith? A lot of us have preventative faith. And that's okay. We pray that God would prevent all manner of calamity. But when the calamity comes, when life falls apart, and when we walk through that valley, have we cultivated a faith that says, even though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil? Why? Because you are with me. And I am more impressed by your presence with me than I am by any of the dangers that surround me or any of the fears within me. God's provision and protection now come together in verse 5, where God is depicted no longer as shepherd, but as host, who invites us to his table. God is so strong that he can set the table for the feast in the presence of enemies. Not only are they not destroying you, you are feasting in front of them. Because he is the one who walks beside us and the host who invites us to his table. He is with us. The God who goes before us, the God who walks beside us. But there's one more piece, and it's the best piece. The God who comes behind us. He is the God who chases us. We take this from the last verse, which in my opinion is the best line in the whole psalm. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. But this word follow is not the best translation because it's not strong enough. The word literally means to chase, to pursue. It's much more aggressive than follow. In fact, throughout the Old Testament, that's the way it's usually translated. It's less a picture of baby ducks following a mother duck and more a picture of a lion pursuing its prey. It chases. Ironically, the message gets it right. Your beauty and love chase after me every day of my life. Remember in Luke 15 when Jesus tells that story of the shepherd? What does the shepherd do? The shepherd leaves the 99 sheep who are safe and goes after the one sheep, chases after the one sheep who has gone astray. Is it possible that Jesus had this passage in mind? This picture of a shepherd who follows behind his flock and even runs after his sheep when they wander into danger. This is the picture that Jesus paints of the Father. God who is a pursuer. When we run, God chases us. You don't have to run. But if you run, God will chase you. Of all the books that we've read to our kids, they're here this morning, by the way, and I'm sure they're glad I pointed that out. My favorite book is this little book called Runaway Bunny. I have it right here. Has anybody read this book? I first began taking this book seriously when I saw a movie called Wit, which is also a play by the same name. And that movie or that play tells the story of a woman who's an English professor. And she's an expert in the poetry of John Donne, which is focused on death and dying. But then she gets diagnosed with stage 4 ovarian cancer. And so she, an expert on poetry about death, now has to process death and dying herself. And she gets weaker and weaker, and she loses her hair. And near the end, her doctoral mentor, her professor, comes to visit her in the hospital. And of all the books or poems that her mentor could have chosen to read, she reads this book, Runaway Bunny, to her as she holds her in her arms. I'd like to share a little bit of it with you. Once there was a little bunny who wanted to run away. So he said to his mother, I am running away. If you run away, says his mother, I will run after you, for you are my little bunny. If you run after me, said the little bunny, I will become a fish in a trout stream, and I will swim away from you. If you become a fish in a trout stream, said his mother, I will become a fisherman, and I will fish for you. If you become a fisherman, said the little bunny, then I will become a rock on the mountain high above you. If you become a rock on the mountain high above me, said his mother, I will be a mountain climber and I will climb to where you are. If you become a mountain climber, said the little bunny, I will be a flower in a hidden garden. If you become a flower in a hidden garden, said his mother, I will be a gardener and I will find you. You get the idea. I won't spoil the ending for you if you'd like to go out and buy it. But why did the doctoral mentor choose to read this book to her former student as she approached the end of her life with all of its uncertainty? Because it is, like many children's stories, a little allegory of the soul. Wherever the soul hides, God can find it. I am running away, says the wayward soul. I will run after you, says the Lord. And he does, because surely goodness and mercy will chase me all the days of my life. You know that Footprints poem, the one about the man who looked back over his life with God and saw two sets of footprints on the beach? And the man was upset at the times that there was only one set of footprints. And God said, well, those were the times when I was carrying you. And so the one set of footprints are mine. And I like that poem. But I wonder if it wouldn't be more accurate to say that if our life with God was represented by two sets of footprints, we would see how often our footprints strayed off to one side or the other, went around in circles viciously, and how often God's footprints followed us off the path, chased us down, and brought us back again and again and again. How goodness and mercy chased us all the days of our life so that we could dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And there's something about that relentless mercy that lets you know that this God can be trusted with your life, with your future, with your fears, with everything. This is why we read this psalm at funerals. Because a God who gives such comprehensive care for his people can be trusted, body and soul, in life and in death, to chase us down. I tremble to preach this psalm, because the truths of it are so precious, almost too good to be true. And perhaps there are some of us who read this and think that it's too good to be true. And how do I know that this picture of God that's been painted in this psalm, of a God who is before me and beside me and behind me, isn't just wishful thinking? It's not just comforting thoughts to make somebody who's afraid feel better about their situation. How do we know that God is really that committed to us, that committed to his people? It's an honest question. It's worth struggling about. But at the end of the day, the answer for the Christian is Jesus. Jesus is God's goodness and mercy made concrete, running out of heaven to chase us down. While we were yet sinners, while we were his enemies, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Jesus is our most clear picture of who God is. If we ever wanted to know how God could prove his commitment to us, we see Jesus, the supreme way that we know that God can be trusted, the supreme way that we know that this psalm is true. And as often as you ask me how I know that God can be trusted, I will say, Jesus. Jesus is the good shepherd. He says, I lay down my life for my sheep. No one takes my life. I give it willingly. And if I lay it down, I will take it again. And because I live, you will live also. He is the God who has gone before us, the God who walks beside us, the God who comes running after us, who continues to run after us, who brings us back to the path through the valley, safely into the house of God forever. Maybe you're here this morning and you are running from God, hiding in plain sight. It's possible even to hide and to run from a church pew, is it not? I used to tell my high school students when I was a youth pastor, as you get ready to graduate and go away to college, do you know what my hope for you is? It's not in how good my sermons were. My hope is in Christ, that He will chase you. You don't have to run. If you run, it will mean brokenness in your life, but if you run, He will chase you. He will chase you all the way to the end. And even beyond. For surely goodness and mercy will chase me all the days of my life, and I will dwell on the house of the Lord forever. Will you pray with me? God, we confess our weak faith. Sometimes we struggle and doubt and disbelieve you. And yet we also praise you that weak faith in a strong Savior is better than strong faith in anything else. We cling to you. We look to you. There are so many dangers, toils, and snares as we walk through the valleys of life. So would you, by your Spirit, open our eyes to see this vision of Psalm 23? Would you give us the confidence of the God who goes before us, companionship with the God who walks beside us, and the courage of knowing that God chases behind us with goodness and mercy? We pray all of this in Jesus' strong name. Amen. Well, there's so many great songs to sing in response to that. But will you join me in singing the song of assurance, Good Shepherd of My Soul?
Thank you.
you can be seated. Come now to the time when we will present our prayers to the Lord, and after the pastoral prayer, we will be taking two offerings. The first offering will be for the Bethel Ministry Fund, and the second offering will be for the Bethel Building Expansion Fund. So will you pray with me? Almighty God, we bring our prayers to you. God, in praying these things, we are not telling you anything you do not already know, but when we bring them to you, we bring you our hearts. We don't understand exactly how prayer works, and yet these things are too important not to bring to you, because you have promised us that every prayer we pray, every tear we cry, every groan of our heart is counted, heard, and seen. So we bring these prayers to you, not because we are good, but because you are good, trustworthy, and faithful. So please hear our prayers with the groanings of your spirit, too deep for words. Lord, we lift up Herm Brenneman, who's been placed in hospice care. We pray for him, Adeline, and their family. As they walk through the valley of the shadow of death, may they fear no evil, for you are with them. May they feel your presence tangibly and deeply and know that they are not alone. We also pray for Kate Cruz, who will be having heart surgery. Bless Kate and her family with courage. Lead them by still waters. Restore their souls. Guide the hands of the physicians and bring health and wholeness, O great physician. We remember that little ones to you belong, and that when we are weak, you are strong. We praise you for those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this week. Truly, every new day, every new year is a testament to your fidelity to us. May we spend our days with purpose and joy. We thank you for Sharon Vregenhill's successful hip surgery in Sioux Falls, and as she returns to Sioux Center Health on Monday, Lord, that she would continue her recovery with grace. We pray for a special closeness that she would feel with you. We lift up the other congregations in our community as they go about the work of your kingdom. Today we pray in particular for Carmel Reformed Church and their pastor, Mike Pitzenberger. Guide them, Lord, to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in your work, for their labor is not in vain. God, we pray for healthy and restored marriages in our community. Teach us how to repent and how to forgive with our spouses. Turn hearts of parents to their children. Keep us from being distracted from this most important ministry. Bless also those who are called to singleness, that their life would be full and complete in you, and that they would bear fruit in every season. Pray for our county, our state, and our country, as well as for our elected leaders. We pray for the peace that comes from justice in our land. When our leaders seek justice and righteousness, bless the work of their hands. When they fail to do so, frustrate their plans and turn their evil for good. God, there is so much noise in our world. Save us from cynicism, from fear, and from despair. And will you raise up believers in every sphere of life who will do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with you? May your church be salt and light, willing to suffer, willing to lose, longing, above all, to bring you glory. God, we belong to you. And though we know that the hope of the world is not the fluency of our prayers or the fervency of our faith, we offer these prayers to you in hope, because our hope, the great hope of the world, is that this world belongs to you, and you are making all things new. So hear these prayers and all of the unspoken cries of our hearts. We offer them to you in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. the kingdom of my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever, and he is mine forever. Where streams of living water flow, my ransomed soul he leadeth. And where the verdant pastures grow, with food the celestial feedeth. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, ruler of my soul, on the mountain high or in the valley low, the King of love my shepherd is, the King of love my shepherd is. Lost and foolish off I strayed, but yet in love he sought me, on his shoulder gently laid, and home rejoicing brought me. In death's dark veil I fear no ill, with thee, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul, on the mountain high or in the valley low, the King of love my shepherd is, the King of love my shepherd is. Shepherd is never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul, on the mountain high or in the valley low, the King of love my shepherd is, the King of love my shepherd is. So through all the length of days, thy goodness faileth never. Good shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever, within your house forever.
Amen. Will you stand with me for a parting blessing? And after the parting blessing, we'll sing a closing hymn, He Leadeth Me. So receive now this parting blessing from Hebrews chapter 13. And may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead the Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.